me money in this bitch, and you know we too legit. Been this size since 1-6, slim, thick, thick lips. Know how to keep my nigga brick on this, stay at the top spot of that wish list, bitch. All right, yo, what's up, everybody? It's your boy, Anya Elite. Thank you so much for tuning in to this very special edition of Funny Money Rock Live, bringing you the latest and inclusive urban entertainment, 100% queer, LGBT, and hip-hop culture here. All right, so today is a very special day because we are introducing our first full-time permanent host. I want you guys to make some noise for Cadence Kyle. Hey, what are you wearing?
Oh my God, this stole my look.
No, see, you stole my look, okay? You know I am the Black Panther aficionado. You see these things here? You know, I love the black stuff or whatever.
Sure you do.
You know, the blacker the berry, the sweeter the juice. You know what I'm saying?
Why I gotta be backwards?
So anyway, tell us why you decided to join Funny Money Rock as a host and what you hope to be bringing to the platform.
Oh my God, I had so much fun the last time we talked, and I just really was looking forward to adding to the conversation and bringing my perspective, hopefully voicing my community as best as possible. And I think it's so odd that we're like on two totally different sides of America, but you know, gays are everywhere.
Everywhere. Like, speaking of gays being everywhere, so shout out to everybody in New York. We're going to start the clock on this topic. But so New York is making history, as it often does, right? But they're making history with the fact that they have elected the first two Black gay U.S. representatives. I mean, that deserves an applause too. You know, Mondaire Jones and Richie Torres, they're going to be headed. Well, they're already at the U.S. House of Representatives now doing the whole new member orientation thing. But they'll take office January 20th with, you know, hopefully Joe Biden as well. You know what I mean?
Amen. And you know we love our strong Black brothers. Worthy of all.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Let's actually take a look at some of what they had to say. Also, I wanted to give, well, I'll tell you why I want to give an extra special shout out to Mondaire on the other side of it.
First openly gay African-American member of Congress.
People are really excited to change the status quo and elect new leadership up and down the ballot.
I will be the first openly gay African-American member of Congress in United States history.
Much of what I do as an elected official when it comes to constituent service is distributing food, personal protective equipment.
The fact is, for most of my life, I never imagined that I could run for Congress, let alone get elected. I grew up in the Baptist church for most of my life until I was around 24 years old. I worked really hard to hide the fact that I'm gay. I get messages from folks all across this country on social media saying that my running as an openly gay candidate, including as an openly gay African-American candidate, is helping them to come to terms with who they are and to live authentic lives.
Baptist, like you. Yes. I love that mug. You always themed with the mug. So on the first episode, which I don't think we have a clip of that, but on the first episode you did with us, you had the Wonder Woman mug, right? Was it Wonder Woman?
Ariel.
It was Ariel. It was the Ariel mug. Yes. My bad. I thought you were going
to. And this time, it is Black Panther. Oh, yes, honey. Yes, yes.
See, and this is why we're here together, because it's kismet, you know? So the reason why I wanted to highlight Mondaire, he's the guy on the right, and it is because, you know, both of them are doing the exact same thing right now. They are making history as the first Black gay U.S. representatives. In Richie Torres's case on the left, I feel like there's been a little bit of disproportionate coverage of them, if you will, in terms of, like, you know, both handsome, attractive men, you know, but it seems like the media has focused more on Richie Torres and his Afro-Latinx, I think he refers to a background. And so, like, I just want to show a little extra love to Mondaire Jones, whose name looks like is unfortunately spelled wrong in the lower thirds. Mondaire Jones is his name, but I think that's incredible. Did you ever think, Cadence, that we would be at this point?
God, I mean, I am so proud of us as a nation. Like, it was clearly time for us as a nation to show up and show out with all of our elections. And I'm just extremely proud of New York for setting the bar high. Callie, where you at? But I'm just really excited. I mean, no, I never imagined. When I think back to my childhood, the expectations for what we could accomplish were very low. It was either, you know, you can be very much in the background of someone else's career, or you could be the sidekick. I'm really excited to see us actually in the forefront with power.
I agree. From first step, House of Representatives, then we'll have a Black, you know, queer person of color senator, and then hopefully to the White House, you know.
Hallelujah.
Shout out to Kamala Harris. I'm probably going to do it wrong. Because she's an AKA. Do you know that? Hello. So, anyway, shout out to the AKAs. Kamala.
My grandmother was an AKA, but yeah.
Shout out to all of them. They're like the auntie. Shout out to all the Divine Nine. But yeah, it's very incredible to see them on there. So after a quick break, we will be back. We're going to talk about Lil Nas's new music video, as well as HBO's outreach to the queer community. They're doing some amazing things. Don't go away. We'll be back in 1 minute. Listen, I do a lot at Icon City, from digital marketing to cannabis activism and marketing. However, I gotta say that Funny Money Rock is my favorite project. You know, it's not easy. It's not easy being an artist. It's not easy being a entrepreneur. It's not easy going after the fullest expression of yourself for anybody, but especially when you're Black and gay, you know, or a queer person of color. And that's what Funny Money Rock is all about. You know, whether I'm hosting the weekly live show and talking to artists, entrepreneurs, and models from all over the world and sharing our unique perspectives.
I celebrate everything Black and gay.
Or rather, when I'm producing shows and getting people on stage, just getting people together, under the banner of 100% LGBT hip hop and R&B is probably my favorite thing that I'm doing right now.
Hey y'all, it's me, Samson McCormick.
This is your boy, Cornell Cecil.
I want you to keep it locked
with Icon City Entertainment.
The Funny Money Rock.
And Icon City News.
The Icon City Entertainment.
For the latest inclusive urban entertainment.
For the most inclusive urban entertainment.
Listen, I do a lot at Icon City, from digital marketing to cannabis activism and marketing.
All right, we're back. Almost ran the same ad twice there. So, where are we going?
You got that cannabis in there twice.
You know it, right? Shout out to Smokin' Sound, smokinsound.com, our sister brand for the latest in inclusive cannabis culture. But what have you been watching on TV, Cadence? Like, this whole pandemic situation, so many of the shows are, like, I feel like it's all game shows and all, like, bleakosity, basically. Like, what have you been watching?
Well, other than all these OnlyFans accounts, I'm just kidding.
Wait, you said all your OnlyFans accounts? Why Chris Brown got one? Why does he,
I mean, because some of us are single, unlike you.
True, but okay. Do you have Chris Brown's one? Because I'm asking for a friend, but...
I ain't got no money for no OnlyFans. I was joking, child. I ain't got no money for no OnlyFans. But what I have had money for is HBO Max, honey. And this is not sponsored, but I am so excited for all the inclusion that they've been having. When they first launched, they had this live lit competition called Legendary, which of course was from our legendary ballroom scene, honey. Honestly, for me, it was like everything that we know and love in ballroom scene condensed into an hour, because you know you could go to a ball and be there all night. And then they also just had this awesome show called Transhood, where they follow the life of several young trans-identifying children for 4 years.
I think we have a clip of that. Let's take a look.
Hey, tell me about what you felt like when you first started doing the documentary.
I started off not really knowing who I was, because, I mean, I was a kid, and I'm 12 now. Here we go!
It started early. 6-7 years old, and she would tell us, I'm a little girl.
I just always knew, I just didn't know the word for it.
Children before puberty do not have medical interventions. It is a social transition.
We lost most of our friends and some of our family.
My family really doesn't talk to me. My mother thinks I'm a child abuser.
Jay was able to get his birth certificate changed to male.
They changed it!
Exception.
Well, it's vital for me to have my parents understand what I'm trying to get at. Being a teenager is just hard enough on its own. Going through puberty as someone that you're not is a little harder.
How do you feel about it, Grandma?
Fine. I've taken care of you since you were 2 months old. You're my grandchild, whether you're male or female.
What's going on? Somebody has your pictures of your book. Somebody knows.
This is not a pleasant time to be out and visibly trans.
Girl boy is a boy wants to be a girl.
You identified as girl boy.
Nuh-uh. Me boy.
We'll call you a girl later if you want.
What I really hope is that people realize we're human. We're not like some exotic species. We have human emotions. That's what matters.
Oh, look at you clutching your pearls. It was really, really great to see. I was so proud of the production value, child. It was a budget.
Well, that's HBO, baby. You know. Coming through with the good production coin.
We ain't talking about no Zeus Network, honey. No shade.
Not the shading of the Zeus. Shout out to Jocelyn and Black China and all of them. They do a very good job. No. Okay. I don't know. out of the mouth of babes, you know, I just, you know, we're not some exotic species. I think that would that put a little lump in my throat. And then also, you know, we'll call you a girl too if you want to change your mind later. Like that parent's response, I thought was great.
And no spoilers, but they definitely were true to a variety of outcomes.
Okay.
So it's not just a rose-colored glass, you know, cell, you know, how people always say we're pushing the gay and trans agenda. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, all roses, and it's not, to me, selling, you know, the idea that everybody should do this with their children. Yeah. There are some, you know, some bad things that happen. Mm-hmm. And I think that it helps really give a perspective that at the end of the day, as the young girl said, we're not, you know, a weird species. We're human. We have ups and downs. We make mistakes. You know what I mean? Sometimes we make choices that we wholeheartedly believe in today. Mm-hmm. And a couple years from now, we don't. Just like some of y'all wholeheartedly wanted to be a hoe in college. And now you hope that your children don't find those pictures.
You know, and it's going to be a shame because I just for all of us, maybe just a couple, like maybe a generation before us, like all this stuff on the internet, everything that we do is just going to, you know, follow us forever. And that's why I have to say, be careful, you know, like when the OnlyFans generation becomes, you know, parents and grandparents, that's going to be very fascinating. We didn't, tell me to move right along because we didn't go through this in the pre-show meeting, but has your personal experience been accepting, and or how would you rate your personal experience?
My experience, I was very fortunate and blessed to be born into a very accepting family. Unfortunately, my mother has passed, but she loved me for me prior to her leaving this earth. My biological father and I have rekindled our relationship, and he's completely accepting of me. My sisters and my brothers love me to death, and some of them have never met me before. So I was very fortunate. Not every one of us is, but I was very fortunate. And, you know, the great thing about whatever choice we make in the spectrum, we should be celebrated as children. And then when we become adults, we can venture into the legendary world and be celebrated there as well, honey.
Speaking of legendary, we have a clip of that. Now, you had said something, you pointed out something interesting about Transhood's casting in the pre-show meeting about, you noticed.
Yeah, ain't no black people.
You notice the absence of black people. And so while we are and normally that would be, I think that they did miss an opportunity because, and we'll talk about it a little bit more later in this episode, but violence against transgender women is of color particularly, is almost at epidemic levels. And so, So there was an opportunity there. My guess was that, you know, in terms of queer outreach, legendary is blackity black black black. So perhaps perhaps that is why. Why they did it that way. But anyway, if you haven't seen it, here's a trailer for Legendary on HBO Max.
What is ballroom?
Ballroom is embracing and captivating.
Ballroom taught me how to be me.
Ballroom truly saved my life.
It's more than dance.
Ballroom is the birthplace of Vogue.
Of Vogue.
Ballroom was founded by Black and Latina transgender women.
Yeah,
We did that. Ballroom is where you get your lingo from.
The tea, the shade.
Serving, darling. Shawam, not shablam.
The ballroom scene is a community.
A community made of houses.
Houses are your chosen families.
Houses compete against each other for trophies, cash, and glory. The ball is where it all...
Have you ever been in a house?
Nah.
Okay. So, I've never been in a house, but I am in a gay family, which I guess, as I tried to explain it to people, like, I guess the only difference is that we did in Vogue. Shout out to the elite, Stefan. Dr. Stefan Elite and all of my elite siblings, I love you. But totally, when I had first moved to Atlanta, like those, I mean, they're still my people, but in you know, coming of age and finding myself and everything like that, you know, just the support, you know, I think, you know, we would sometimes roommate with, you know, each other. We'd pool resources a lot. And so, you know, even though, like, it kind of, I had some moments where I'm like, okay, you know, I'm a grown-ass man and, you know, calling somebody by dad or whatever, like, you know, that's kind of, at point in times, that's been odd or at least hard to explain to other people. But, you know, the support has been amazing. And I know many, well, not many, but some houses have even went as far as to become nonprofit organizations to offer up scholarships and types of programs like that. So I think it's amazing. But did you see enough Black people?
I saw plenty of Black people. I mean, I have to say that, you know, in a former life before I lived in New York, I lived in Minnesota. And I was a part of the beginning wave when the ballroom scene was introduced in Minnesota. And I did, much like you, I had a gay family that didn't Vogue. So we were essentially a house. However, we weren't created or founded under the same guise of the ballroom scene. I had initiated more of a family mentorship kind of family in my, right, in my, out of my own apartment. And many of our family members are still in communication. I saw a lot of Black people in that clip, but who I didn't see were the judges. And one of the judges was our girl, Meg Thee Stallion.
Shout out to
Meg. Speaking of Meg Thee Stallion, inquiring minds want to know, are you team Meg or Tory?
Okay, so since the pause in my answer is already going to result in dragation, I'm sure. Let me just say that I do not condone violence against our women, and we need to protect our women. This feels partially on both of their parts, very, in ways, publicity driven. And so, you know, I hope that it's not, you know, but they both have seemed to kind of move on so cavalier. Like, I know there's a court case running through, but they're just the way that, you know, they've kind of both moved forward publicly, you know, because I know if someone shot me and I didn't expect it coming and stuff like that, I don't know if I'm rushing to perform or like I'm doing some things differently, you know. So
you with the conspiracy theorists? That's what you're saying.
I'm not with the conspiracy. I don't know.
I'm hearing very much conspiracy theories. I'm team Meg on period. Okay. I ain't listening to no Tory Lanez, nothing. I ain't watching no live streams. I ain't listening to no 17 track album. It's not happening. I did listen to my girl Meg Good News, honey. Body is an anthem, okay? Especially since we all gained quarantine weight. But, you know, what y'all really need to be listening to is those shots fired. That shots fired track is, that's where the money at. That's what we needed to hear.
Is she addressing the situation?
Oh, yes, honey. Okay, in true hip hop fashion.
Okay. Well, let me hear that. You know, and I just, you know, again, I guess, and you know, part of being an artist is, you know, sharing your experiences and sharing what happens to you and everything like that. But again, like, you know, I mean, even on his part, like a whole freaking album ready, like, I mean, I know it was a little time, but like, so like, you know, he must have went directly to the studio after. I mean, they both must have went directly to the studio after this thing happened.
Well, it has been several months. This has been dragging out for a while. I understand the fatigue. I think 2020 is a year of fatigue. Like, we just tired. We tired of the COVID-19. We tired of this president. We tired of these election commercials. We tired of, you know what I'm saying, the drama. Yes. So I understand that aspect. But I do think that oftentimes, you know, we're putting everything through a trial. We're tiptoeing. I ain't got time for that. I'm Team Meg, period. Okay.
Shout out to Meg. And no violence against women. And we're totally against that. And I'm personally very much against that. I will say, last thing on the Megan thing, I just want you to, not on some blame the victim shit, but to hopefully choose your company a little bit wiser yourself, especially when you have like these opportunities to like, you know, Beyonce's rolled out the red carpet for you.
But you know, sometimes it'd be hard. You know, see, you in a relationship, you forgetting what it's like to be single. You know, Trey be getting in your mind.
And she be
up. You be like, I told him I don't spend money on no niggas. And somehow I'm still paying this nigga phone bill.
Honey, girl, she done probably bought 5 PS5s. You know, because Michael, apparently, what's his name? Michael B. Jordan getting one from her for sure, apparently. You know what I'm saying? But if you like him, he seems to be, wait. I'm just saying, if you like him, then be with him. You know? And like, you know, I just, you gotta be careful. You act too much like a video hoe, they'll treat you like a video hoe. Let's get off of this subject because I'm digging myself. Ooh! Okay, so we'll be right back after a break. I can't even get out of here fast enough. Be right back. It's every city, getting big money Saturday, Sunday, even though it's Monday, walk with me, every day be a Monday. Now I ain't gonna sell it cause you already see it, but when you come back, I can tell that you need it, boy. It's on you right, it's on you right. Yo, if I'm the shot, then you could be. Okay, so that was a quick one. We are back again, welcoming Cadence Kyle as our new Funny Money Rock permanent host. Okay, so now that I've recovered from that that last segment, that was a very unfair question of you to ask me because, you know, I got to keep it real. But, like, you know.
Yeah, keep it real.
Anyway, well, I know somebody I'm sure you are excited to support, which is our loving friend, Lil Nas X, who has been out here serving.
Definitely. I definitely want to give it up to Lil Nas X, his new video. It's a holiday. I got hoes on hoes and they out of control, yo. Hey, this another way. All my niggas on go and I hope that you know. That is I love the visual of it. You know, people who have been, you know, following the Icon City brands and everything like that will know that in the past I have been critical of queer artists that have mainstream backing for basically not being as in the forefront about their, you know, about their music, about their lifestyle, you know, and not including it in their lyrics. But, you know, he has a joke in there about being a top or a bottom. I also like the line that he makes about, you know, acknowledging that, you know, the whole cowboy horse thing was kind of like a gimmick or whatever. And just like, you know, like will I bump this song forever to the end of times? No. You know, I'm still waiting on my gay Jadakiss, my gay Jay-Z, my gay, you know, for that to really, like, you know, pop. But visually incredible. Lyrical content in terms of in the frame of being a pop artist, fantastic. And you know, I can't wait to see how much further he's gonna be able to go with these checks and stuff, and you know, because I mean, they're giving him the money to do it, so you know, I hope that he's able to continue working in his, you know, unique personality. He's obviously been in the gym, kudos.
Yeah, like I said, I'm really excited for our representation, and I think that, you know, it's a process. Some people have to crawl for other people to walk. You know what I mean? Before we were able to get to Jadakiss's, we had African Bambaataa's. There was a process to hip hop that elevated and evolved to where it is now. Mm-hmm. And much like women in hip hop went through their evolutions, I think that it will take some time for us to get to that evolved version of a gay hip hop artist that we really feel like is on par. And the industry is changing. So, you know, the backing of labels and what they're able to push has changed. The marketing has changed. And it's just going to take a while. It may take a while for an artist to get the right footing. But I'm just really excited to see him living in his truth. You know, we all know about his kind of insecurity in the beginning with being a Nicki Minaj fan. And then full circle, he was getting his life, honey, for Halloween as Nicki Minaj. Oh my God.
I wish I had that picture.
He
did that. He really did that. I think the androgynous aspect of it is crazy. He did 24 million views of his of that latest music video, by the way. But yeah, the Nicki thing was incredible. And just similarly, you know, again, my comment about wanting the Jadakiss is not even like a reflection so much on him in the essence that, like, but you know, when that period when Nicki Minaj kind of reintroduced people to female rap, you know, now there's, fast forward to now, there's, you know, you have so many options for what you want. You have your Megan, you have your Cardi, you have your Nicki, and then you have, I don't want to say it's the second string, but you have, then you got your City Girls and your Saweeties and your Doja Cat, which is like, I really do not want to like her, but baby, she got this mashup.
Why you don't want to like Doja Cat?
Because she, before she got on, there was this history she would do, like, she would go on to, she would coon for white supremacists, you know, back in the day or whatever.
One thing that I get annoyed with our social media era is that we push narratives and things that don't be having complete validity to them. I know the drama that happened with the video chat rooms that Doja Cat was in. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I just think that we also have to remember that, like, there was a time when people gave us their art and entertainment and not their entire lives. And at this point, we just are really too involved in people's lives. I saw the clips from the live streams. Mm-hmm. I really felt like people were pressing and feeding into something they just didn't understand. But I also feel like, you know,
help me understand it.
I feel like also, like, you know, we have to stop really expecting our celebrities to be 100% perfect. It's not realistic. The majority of us do not want somebody randomly to just go through our phone and see the text messages and the things that we say, because we can all be problematic. We're human beings. At the end of the day, she is very talented. Yes. And I love her music. You know what I'm saying? I'm not expecting Doja Cat to teach my children, you know, self-respect. I'm expecting her to put out a song that I'm gonna be bumping in the mirror or in the club. You know, sometimes I think we push past. But circling back to the whole point of the start of this conversation is, like you said, you know, with the Nicki Minaj introducing the female hip hop icon to the world, and then subsequently allowing us to have a barrage now of more females in hip hop who are actually getting their flowers. That took essentially 5 or 6 years, right? Because, you know, when the budgets cut out for Kim and Rim and Eve, and, you know, they stopped being the it girls. And then all of a sudden, here came Nicki, you know, proving that there was still money to be made, because let's keep in mind, this is still a business. Mm-hmm. And Nicki proved that people were still willing to pay them coins, right, for a woman in hip hop. So now, yes, we have companies and we have more opportunities. And I think it's the same way, you know, maybe Lil Nas X can show these companies, mm-hmm, but the gays will spend some coin for our own hip hop artists. And then I can get signed to a contract. Hello.
Hello.
Just saying.
Hello. No, we definitely need it. Switching gears is actually a perfect segue, because I was having a conversation with Fox Giselle. I think I mentioned her to you last time we talked, but she's she's basically one of she's the original trans rapper, in my opinion. And I'm sure dates and stuff will probably bear that out as well. And we were talking on her live not too long ago, and we were talking, it was right after another trans woman was murdered, and we were just trying to figure out what it will take to get people like the little girl in the trans hood video said, to realize that, you know, these are human beings just like everyone else, and not some weird thing to be ashamed of. And so my idea was that, you know, we need, it's really on more so than we need a prominent trans leader, you know, because I think we have so many of those already, you know, when I think of Laverne Cox and
Janet Mock.
Janet Mock and
Dominique.
And Dominique. Like, you know, just, you know, we could go on and on. And so You know, what I think more importantly than them now is that we need to spotlight the men in their lives, or a man needs to promote his transgender attraction, like, and needs to, and once, and
like
once,
Malik Yoba.
Well, is he? I mean, well, or and the guy from Ed McCrary, did you, Darius McCrary too? He's been showing a lot of love to Sydney Starr. But I guess we need that, but we need them to have a show. Okay, you know, of like the love of the
family. We'll need nobody else to have no more shows, child. I'm tired of reality TV. Mm-hmm.
I think what we really need is we need to
stop pushing the narrative that our differences really make us that much different.
Mm-hmm.
And that's across the board. It's not okay. just about gender identity or sexual orientation, it's also about race, it's also about economics. I mean, we really need to stop, and I think that's why it was so important for us to get the Cheeto in Chief out, because the divisiveness of our nation was ridiculous. Everybody to push why they were so different or why they were so much more important. At the end of the day, we're all human. We all have the same basic needs. We need safety and shelter. We need food and water. We need love and companionship. And we need to stop creating a hierarchy of... We need to stop creating a hierarchy of better or worse based off of who you're attracted to. You know, if you're attracted to the right type of woman, then you're better than someone who's attracted to a different type of woman. It's getting ridiculous.
Yes, definitely. And the reason why I wanted to talk about this today is because, and I'm going to join the chorus, every time that something like this happens, we're going to be bringing it to you guys. But during Transgender Visibility Week and just days before Transgender Day of Remembrance, our community, the LGBT community, is once again mourning the loss of one of our own in the case of Yuri Carey. Yuri Carey is from the Miami area, but grew up with close ties to the Los Angeles area. Her death marks the 37th known murder of a transgender or gender non-conforming person this year. And it reflects the larger epidemic of violence against the transgender community, which disproportionately impacts Latina and Black trans women. Anything that you want to add to this?
It's just so sad. Every time I hear another one of these stories, my heart drops. And not just for the trans community and the person who lost their life, but also for the man that took her life. Because at the end of the day, these are two lives that are ruined. And every time one of us is murdered, there are multiple lives that become casualties. The people that love them, the people that know them, and the people who are supported or supporters of them. At the end of the day, all lives really do matter, as cliche as that sounds. We need to stop. We need to stop pushing so much fear. And it's sad that, you know, she died trying to live her truth. And subsequently, oftentimes, it's at the hand of someone who is trying to hide their truth. Not specifically in Ms. Carey's case, but too often that is the case.
Definitely. You know, like I said, we ought to call it what it is. It is an epidemic. As much as COVID-19, as much as police brutality, it is an epidemic. What makes me the angriest is that, I would say in all likelihood, in this case, but maybe not in this case, but in most cases, a lot of times the assailant is, in cases where the trans individual is a person of color, the assailant is also a person of color. And, you know, that just irks me. And you know, like you said, if this keeps happening because someone is ashamed of who they love, like you're saying, the assailants in many of these cases, someone needs to talk to them specifically. Like this is even less of a conversation for it's a conversation for everyone, but that very specific aspect is even less of a conversation for random Joe Schmo, who is, you know, truly heterosexual, is solely cisgendered attracted. Is that how I would? Yeah, so to people who are strictly cis attracted, I think it's even less of a conversation for them as it is for, individuals who are trans attracted, and they need examples. And that's why I go back to that, you know, the reality show, the visual campaign centering that guy that, yeah, I play football, I rap, I go to the barbershop, whatever, and like, you know, and this is who I love, and like, you know, there's nothing you can do about it, and there's no shame and stuff like that. And you know, as soon as that right story is told, and is promoted, it will be a game changer. And so I just pray for that day. You know what I'm saying?
I worry to reality TV. I worry about us really encouraging the expectation that reality TV can help shape or encourage the behaviors of our communities. You know what I mean? I get what you're saying in terms of, I think more likely, I think along the lines of what you're saying, I could see a public couple, a more known trans icon getting into a public relationship that displays, you know, trans love. Mm-hmm. So in the same way that we celebrate Black love with Will and Jada, right?
Right, right.
Not necessarily that they're on a reality TV show, but we equate, you know, Black excellence love to the type of relationship that they have and the way that they talk things out and the way that they handle their public perception. Yeah.
Okay.
But so I don't want no Love and Hip Hop style.
Okay. Well, yeah, no, I don't want Love and Hip Hop. Okay, well, I don't know if you get into the OWN TV reality show. They have a fresh approach to how they do their reality. It's a slightly little bit more wholesome. I know I might be talking outside of our age demographic, but OWN TV has good stuff.
Only thing I watch on OWN is Yala, and she's finna be over after the season, so that's it.
Love and Marriage, Huntsville, baby.
Oh, and Queen Sugar.
Right?
Queen Sugar was lit.
Okay. And Love and Marriage, Huntsville is cute. So is that Ready for Love, or it's like a big dating show or whatever. They're cute. They're wholesome.
I don't know.
They're wholesome. Anyway, I have a brunch burger that I ordered prior to us doing this that I've been thinking about all show long. So I'm really excited to be getting to it. But yeah, I'm excited that you are here. I'm, you know, if you guys have any, as you can see, you can follow Cadence at the Cadence Kyle, you know, I mean, cause I get a lot of DMs and stuff about like, oh, feature me on Funny Money Rock, feature me on this. DM her now and ask her to feature you on Funny Money Rock and, you know, it'll, you know, get done if she answers your DM.
And just so you guys know, we are currently working on a schedule for us to do this weekly. So you can drop down in the comments and give us topics that you want us to talk about. And we'll be happy to try our best to bring our perspective again from coast to coast in America on everything LGBTQ plus.
You know what I think we need? I think we need a third cause. I think we need to bring Atlanta into this situation.
Oh, yes, honey.
Listen, if you think you have what it takes to dish on the latest in LGBT hip hop culture, send us an email at info@iconcity.net. And we're going to have some auditions and see who's going to join us on this panel.
And you don't have to worry about stealing your outfit.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait. Yeah. No, this will not happen again. I'm wearing something. We're gonna get together about what our fashion ideas are next time. All right. So we will see you guys next Saturday for Funny Money Rock. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe.
Wash your hands and wear a mask.
Bye, guys. Money in this bitch, and you know we too legit. Been this size since 1-6, slim, thick, thick lips. Know how to keep my nigga brick on this. They at the top spot of that wish list, bitch.